Hi, I'm Caroline. I'm a normal student. At 9 a.m. every morning, I go to school. I like studying maths and science, and I'm particularly good at those subjects. After school, I try a football club with my friends. Then, I come home and eat dinner with my family. I love my mom's best dish, fried chicken. One day, I woke up feeling something was wrong. Since then, I had trouble sleeping at night, and was usually late for school the next morning. I couldn't concentrate in class. Mama was somewhere outside the window. I didn't enjoy playing football with my friends as much as I used to. I didn't even feel hungry when my mom made me the fried chicken I loved. My parents were worried, so they took me to the doctor. The doctor asked me to fill in some forms about my symptoms, and I was diagnosed with a major depressive disorder. I was so worried, since I thought if people knew I had a mental problem, they would isolate me. However, the doctor came up to me and told me she wanted to explain about depression, specifically the causes of depression in school, because that is where she thinks my issue came from. She said,
"Common mental disorder characterized by persistent sadness and a loss of interest in activities that you normally enjoy, accompanied by an inability to carry out daily activities for at least 2 weeks. Some symptoms of depression include loss of energy, change in appetite, sleeping more or less, anxiety, reduced concentration, feeling of worthlessness, guilt or hopelessness, thoughts of self-harm or suicide."
Globally, 350 million people have depression according to WHO in 2018. Additionally, suicide, which links with depression, claims the lives of over 800,000 people annually across the globe. A survey that our group conducted from 60 adolescents aged 12 to 18 within the local area showed that on a scale of 1 to 5, where 1 is the lowest level of depression and 5 is the highest level of depression, 18.3% reported having depression at level 3, 10% at level 4, and 8.3% at level 5. Additionally, 46.7% claim that depression has a big impact on teenagers, while 41.7% said depression has a severe impact. Now, my friends who are experts in adolescent mental health will explain to you more about this problem.
First of all, a common factor which leads to adolescent depression is bullying. Bullying is unwanted or aggressive behaviors among school-aged children that involves a real or perceived power imbalance. There are many ways that students in schools can be bullied, either through modern methods or traditional methods, or even both, which is highly likely. Traditional methods are where the students are bullied face-to-face in schools, verbally, physically, and socially, while the modern method includes the use of the internet, social medias. A study showed that students have a 25.9% to 33% chance of being bullied with the traditional method, and 22.9% of the students are affected by cyberbullying. This means that students are being bullied in schools rather than online. In addition, students who are LGBTQ have a high chance of getting bullied as they are considered being a sexual minority. This means that their sexual belief is different from society's standard. Among students in schools, 10% to 20% of them are experiencing bullying. This is more likely to happen to boys rather than to girls, as girls tend to stay out of these situations. Being a victim of bullying or being the bully increases the chances of developing depression and anxiety disorders among adolescents who are in the age range of 9 to 12. Students who are affected by bullying have a 90% chance of developing this mental issue, and these symptoms will stay around for 2 years. However, the severity of the effects are higher for girls than for boys, even though it happens less for girls. In addition to having depressive disorders, they will have a high chance of having suicidal thoughts, psychiatric symptoms, and drug abuse. Not only is bullying a cause for depression, but depression can also be a cause for bullying. It affects both ways. From our local area, 60 students ages from 12 to 18 took a survey, and 80.3% of them reported to have been bullied, and 28.3% of them were both the bully and the victim.
The second cause I'm going to talk about is teenagers' relationship in school. In this project, the definition of a relationship is the commitment to love and be loved of two partners. These relationships are very common among teenagers, as 80% of teens aged 14-year-old to 17-year-old were or have been in a romantic relationship, and a small number of same-sex relationships, 2-3%. The survey that we made shows that in our local community, 71.7% of teenagers have been in a relationship, and the same percentage was also heartbroken at some point. The reason for this is the rise in sex hormones and the attraction towards the opposite genders. These relationships can be beautiful and memorable, but they can also cause serious mental issues, specifically depression. Depression rate is known to increase rapidly over adolescence, but it increases more for teens who are romantically involved, especially for the first time. In this case, romantically involved means that the cause of depression is not only caused after breaking up, but also during the relationship as well. During the relationship, partly because of not fully developed mindsets, one partner can experience physical or psychological aggression from the other. For example, being thrown at, hit, threatened, and insulted. Romantic relationships in school also increase the level of teenagers' stress because they have to remain hidden from adults, parents, and teachers who would get angry at them for being in the relationship. According to several studies, breakups have a link with the rise of depression, especially for teens who experience mood disorders. Ex-partners can share private photos or information on social media as a method of revenge, which embarrass the other partner. Another issue of teenagers' romantic relationship is unrequited love. In this case, teens can be so obsessed with their love that they create intense imaginations that the person they love loves them back too. These fantasies can be a great pain if reality is the other doesn't actually love them back. Then, the teens will experience great sorrow, which can lead to depression and low self-esteem, or even worse, self-harm. Additionally, another study found that teens that are involved in romance have the depression levels increased more or decreased less than teens that are not involved. This result was drawn from approximately 8,200 teens who were interviewed with a one-year gap between the interviews. At the first interview, the interviewees were 12 to 17-year-olds.
School is one of the many causes for adolescent depression where students stress over their schoolwork. There was also research made where an estimated 3.1 million adolescents aged 12 to 17 in the United States had at least one major depressive episode in 2016. Some of the factors which cause students to stress out a lot and so lead to depression over their schoolwork would be upcoming tests, challenging classes, which means the classes may be too hard for the student's level, transitioning to a new environment where the students may study abroad and have to learn more about the culture, or where the students can just simply change schools where things are just different. For example, when students transfer from public school to private school, it can be very alarming where many things have changed, where the student would have to change their style of studying and learning since private schools are known to be more formal, which for sure can be very stressful and then lead to depression. However, one of the main causes in the long term to stress over schoolwork would be too much homework or too little time to complete the homework. As homework is given almost every day, in the long term, there will be an experience of depression as the adolescent stresses over the schoolwork a lot. A lot of stress can be created when homework is given. According to a research conducted by Stanford University, students in high-achieving communities who spend too much time on homework experience more stress, physical health problems, and a lack of balance in their lives, and alienation. There was also an interview where 4,300 students at 10 high-performing high schools in upper-middle-class California communities. The result says when it came to stress, more than 70% of students said they were often or always stressed over schoolwork, with 56% listing homework as a primary stressor. Less than 1% of the students said homework was not a stressor.
Because adolescent depression is rising to be a major concern, countries are making measures to prevent and solve the current problem. In Zimbabwe, the communities usually go to a traditional healthcare system where they will use traditional herbs to try and reduce the illness. However, that does not seem to be helpful because 48% of the population who use this method still have depressive disorders. So a better solution for that would be the Friendship Bench, founded by Dr. Dixon Chibanda. This method uses a speech-based therapy where grandmothers are used to help listen and give advice for the patient. This method is done in 6 sessions within 4 to 6 weeks, each session being held for 35 to 40 minutes. There are 3 stages within each session, first opening the mind, second uplifting, and third is strengthening.
In the first stage, it is about getting details and the list of problems with the client via listening to their stories.
The second stage is to identify and prioritize a problem, then decide ways of solving it. The third stage is for the grandmother to go to the client's house and listen to what they have to say.
Using the friendship bench, the chance for people to get depressive disorders is only 12% compared to 48%, which is using the standard.
Option in Australia is to increase in funding to solve problems about mental health. For example, in 2018, the government funded $110 million to tackle depression and anxiety, including $46 million to teach students about good mental health, as $13.5 million will be allocated to the Origin National Center of Excellence in Youth Mental Health. Psychiatrist Patrick McGorry, the executive director of Oregon, said the funding would help to maintain youth mental health services, including headspace centers throughout Australia. Online and phone support services such as the Kids Helpline and Reach Out are created for children and adolescents to have someone to share their emotions and issues rather than keeping everything inside. As said by Jason Threatowen, Chief Executive Officer of Headspace, when students are feeling a little bit down or have issues at home, often they go to a teacher for support. We will be there on the front line, working with those school communities to help them work with those young people and families. Furthermore, mental health care is starting to be taken more seriously in Australia through increase in these fundings. According to McGorry, the announcement shows that the Health Minister Greg Hunt has been listening to the sector, and this funding will mean vital support services for young people.
Adolescent depression in Vietnam is a major concern, as the diagnosis of depression was 41.1% in 2013. Depression rate was also predicted to increase sharply in the future, along with the development of social networking sites, proven by about 25.9% of the students having their depressive symptoms elevated and 18.7% having depressive symptoms, as well as a major depressive disorder. It was also found that depression was the strongest factor that leads to suicide, as 26.3% of the students thought of committing suicide, 12.9% made a suicidal plan, and 3.8% attempted. Adolescent depression being a rising issue in Vietnam is mainly because Vietnam's system and organizations to monitor and prevent or cure depression are not efficient enough. A regular management program hasn't been created yet, and the management of depressed patients is only working in some pilot models. There is no solution taken to prevent mental illnesses, especially adolescent depression in the communities, schools, families, and workplaces. Let's consider two different situations where the mentioned solutions, the Friendship Bench of Zimbabwe and the increase in funding for mental health care of Australia, are applied by the Vietnamese government to solve the issues of adolescent depression. On one hand, the Friendship Bench of Zimbabwe can be beneficial to the current concern of depression. Instead of using grandmothers to help in the hospital only, the grandmothers can also be used in schools to talk to teens about their daily problems as a school counselor. A survey conducted in 2013 shows that 78.8% of the students in Vietnam think there should be a school counselor to help them, and having an after-school tutor was proven to reduce the chances of getting in depression by 28%. Within our local area, the survey we conducted also showed that 78.3% of teens think that having a school counselor would be beneficial. Furthermore, grandmothers can keep contact and give support to teens via a website, with a little bit of help from technicians, to build a website and teach the grandmas how to use it. This will contribute in creating a healthier environment for teens in Vietnam, as 90% of the students said they will visit websites that provide emotional support for teens, and about 64% strongly agreed that students should share their private issues and look for help on those sites. The current social protection institutions have activities that support 30% of people in difficult situations, which is a relatively low number. However, this number can be risen up with the use of grandmothers, potential source of labor, particularly in emotional support. On the other hand, Australia's solution to increase people's access, specifically funding on adolescent depression, seems to be impractical when applied to Vietnam. Australia is a developed country, hence the government can afford to spend $110 million on solving youth depression and anxiety. In contrast, Vietnam as a developing country can only spend $2 million on mental health in total for each year. Furthermore, if Vietnam gets enough funding for mental health care, the best solution is building more hospitals to increase people's access. Since 27 out of 64 provinces in Vietnam have a separate mental hospital, and the others only have a department for mental health care in their district hospital. Also, there are only 600 outpatient facilities in Vietnam for patients with mental illnesses, including 4% of beds in mental hospitals reserved for children and adolescents, but no beds reserved for them in community-based hospitals. This means that only 27 provinces' hospitals have 4% of beds reserved for children and adolescents, which is clearly insufficient. However, building a hospital takes a really long time and is not efficient enough for the current number of depressed patients. Finally, the Vietnamese culture makes it hard for hospitals to help depressed patients because of social stigma. According to the director of a mental hospital in Ho Chi Minh City, if someone in the family has depression, anxiety, or psychosis, they will hide it. Sometimes they go for health examinations, but they mostly will hide it from other people.
According to a study, patients who are diagnosed with psychiatric disorders are more likely to have a correlation with depression rather than bullying. In addition, researchers also show that being bullied at the age of 8 would not lead to depression in the later ages. Studies have shown that different diets also have an effect on linking with depression. This is because the brain needs nutrients, and if those nutrients are unbalanced, then it could make the brain function differently, causing depressive symptoms. A study shows that whole foods such as fruits and vegetables lowers the chances of getting depression, while people who ate processed food had a higher chance of getting depression. Processed foods include processed meats, grains, and fast food.